We're here today with Superintendent of Public Instruction, Jack O'Connell. Jack, thank you very much for joining us today. Jack, you're headed into your last year as superintendent. Looking back over the past 7 years, what would you say your one or two accomplishments that you're most pleased with?
Well, thank you for having me, John, and thank you for all your great work in public education. The students of this community, the state, have really benefited from your work. I'm really very pleased with our work in closing the achievement gap. The achievement gap, so that we're all on the same definition, is when we extrapolate our data and when we look at our subgroups. And these are some of our subgroups that are growing the fastest and are the largest, based upon ethnicity, socioeconomic conditions. When we look upon our English language learners dramatically growing, and our special education students. The good news is we've seen academic progress. What we haven't seen in the past have been narrowing that gap to where our white and Asian students are. We know all students can learn. We know all students can learn to very high levels. And we want to continue to push all of our students, but at the same time, accelerate the narrowing of that gap, which has been dramatic. And so because of the work of the very hardworking group, the statewide California P16 Council, which I appointed, because of the hard work of our professional educators, greater community involvement and awareness about this gap, we are now seeing, really for the first time, an incremental narrowing of the achievement gap.
And so, Jack, that is a stubborn gap, as you know.
It is.
And looking back, how might you tackle that? If you had it to start over again, how might you tackle it differently?
Well, I would certainly still tackle it.
Yeah.
There have been some cases where I have misspoken, and I think at times even portrayed a totally inaccurate perception that some kids can't learn, and that's why I'm always quick to say, we know all students can learn, we know all students can learn to very high levels. And this really is a new economy. It's a new economy for all of our students, and it requires higher level critical thinking skills, analytical skills, problem solving skills. We all must be critical thinkers, better communicators, and technologically proficient. And that applies to all of our students. We know all students can learn, so we need to make sure that we can reach all of our students.
So looking at that issue, are there structural barriers to narrowing the achievement gap? Is it getting better teachers in low-performing schools? Is it perhaps more funding for low-income and minority students? Is it longer day? I mean, look at it in terms of looking ahead. How do you tackle that issue?
It's really everything, John. It takes an entire community to help us educate a child, and it takes an entire community to help us close that achievement gap. It's really all of the above. Our P16 Council came up with the acronym ACES. And what ACES stands for is the A is access, the C for culture and climate, the E for expectations, and the S for strategies. And just briefly, the access is we want to make sure that all of our students have access. We'll begin very early on with quality preschool. That's really a great equalizer and can really help us. Access to the A through G curriculum in school. Access to some of our best and brightest teachers. The E is for expectations. Do we truly have high expectations for all of our students, or is that just a slogan? The C, I should go my alphabet here, C for culture and climate. Do we really have that environment so all of our students can in fact not just survive but be able to thrive? Are there any built-in impediments? We went out and have done surveys of students and of teachers. Majority of the teachers said there are no impediments for many of these students of color, students learning a language to learn. And when we ask the students, it's the opposite. And our students then say, yes, they do believe that there are some impediments and some obstacles that we need to overcome. And so we have the ACE, and then the S for ACEs would be strategies. And how can we share best practices? How can we reach some of the students that have historically not been able to benefit to the same degree? Do we have a different allocation of resources? Where are some of our best and brightest teachers working? How can we address this? And a race to the top legislation, the regulations, and the grant that we're going after, the application that I just signed recently with the governor and with the president of the state board, that will help us, I believe, get some of our most effective teachers and school leaders to some of our more challenging schools that we have.
Yeah, so appreciate that. I know many people appreciate the fact that you have raised the achievement gap and been very outspoken in getting that issue out there. Before we get into the next year and race to the top, one more thing that you look back over your 7 years and say, I'm glad we did that and I was part of that.
You know, I'm really pleased with the school facilities. We're building more schools. We've been able to modernize more schools. We're able to make sure that our schools more accurately reflect our businesses and our offices here. And so we've been able to get that money out the door. We've been able to build smart schools, more green schools, more energy efficient schools, and I'm really pleased with that. And then, of course, I think in my starting 28 years now of public service, state service, I'm most proud of my work on the passage of Proposition 39. That's the 55% vote for local bonds and the leadership of great educational leaders like John Doerr and Reed Hastings and John Chambers and so many others. Now we need to do the parcel tax, the 55%, which is contained by Senator Joe Simiti in SCA 6. That would return more local control to our local school districts and I think further enhance educational opportunities for more students.
So now we're in your last year, Jack. What's the one big issue you would like to deal with and wrap up your career as superintendent over the next year?
Well, that assumes we've been able to eliminate the achievement gap. So yep. We're going to continue to work hard on addressing achievement gap issues and making sure that our test scores continue to improve and that we have that learning environment so every single student, each student, can reach his or her full maximum potential. We've also done a lot in the area of career technical education. When I first began, we had 289 A through G classes in career tech. These would be classes accepted by UC, CSU. We have raised the standards in career tech, and we're now approaching the 8,000 classes, high school career tech, that are A through G. But I want to make sure that we have that environment so that we're using data. We have a longitudinal data system that we've done in place now the last 2 years. We can allocate resources. We can tell best practices, what programs are working, by tracking students. So we'll be able to make more educational policy based upon real research, not just intuition or theory or somebody's idea, but really now look and see the importance of childcare, the importance of class size reduction. And I'm the biggest class size reduction advocate you'll ever meet. And we'll have more data in terms of the analysis and the effectiveness of these kinds of programs.
If there's class size left after the current year.
That's a fair observation, regrettably. And as the one who wrote the law, it really pains me that because of the inadequate funding from Sacramento, more and more school districts are being forced to jam their class sizes. I've been in some, John, 40 students or more in some classrooms. But class size reduction works. Talk to any teacher, and that teacher will tell you they can provide a more individualized, personalized learning opportunity for those students.
I wish we had more time to talk about class size reduction, because that is an interesting issue. Looking back in the issue of financing, are you worried that perhaps 10 years from now, people will look back at the 2000 and say, decade, and say, this was a time when California saw the decline in its schools for its failure to establish a sufficient and predictable stream of funding?
There's no question about it, John. And as I look back, that's my biggest regret, that I have not been more successful in being able to advocate and lobby and successfully deliver that stable, predictable revenue source for our schools. It's been very hard on our school system. And that said, we're continuing to see academic improvement and achievement. It's a resilient system. Our teachers, our classified personnel, our administrators really are our heroes. They are our leaders who are making a difference. Everyone knows you're not going to get rich by entering the teaching profession. I mean, I'm a teacher. I taught high school and will always remain involved and supportive of public education. Nobody enters the teaching profession to get rich, nor do you take an oath of poverty. And we need to make sure that we are adequately compensating and attracting the best and the brightest amongst us to this important profession.
Now, finally, Jack, I know Race to the Top fits into your plans for the current year. And first of all, how important is that to what you plan to do over the next year? And then if California does not get this first round, what do you think we need to do to encourage more districts and unions to sign into this?
Well, I'm pleased that we had over 800 LEAs sign up for the Race to the Top.
LEAs meaning districts and charter schools.
School districts and charter schools, local education agencies. I'm hopeful that we'll be recipients of a grant for the Race to the Top. I'm motivated even more for the systemic educational reform that's contained in Race to the Top than I am the potential maximum we could receive, $700 million over 3 years. But it is an unprecedented amount of money to implement the right reform.
Jack O'Connell, it's always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for coming by, and we're going to check in with you at the end of the year.
Great.
See how it went. Thanks for watching. This is John Fensterwald for The Educated Guest.